It's dry.
You're good. How many you got?
Eyes are starting to water up a little
bit. He's got two more. Let's go, man.
Let's go.
He's actually dogging him. He's doing pretty well. Like, he's just not talking, but...
Oh, here comes the
hiccups. Hiccups coming. Fuck.
Nice.
Oh! You got this.
I'm sweating.
It's hot.
I can't...
No milk, guys. You can do this. Just think, a month from now, this video is just legendary in your book.
Sheesh! Oh, he needs some milk!
It's cold shit, too.
And I'm joined by Atlanta Falcons NFL receiver Greg Dortch. My man, what's going on, dude?
What's up with you guys, man? Tyreek Hill is fun to watch. Just because of his size, like he's roughly the same size as me. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So I have to respect his game. Davante Adams, he's very like smart and technical. I work out with Keenan Allen every offseason, so we kind of have like a connection together. So just being able to work out with him, it's like see what he does to be so successful. I would definitely respect his game. Let me see. DK Metcalf is a freak of nature. Like I went to the combine. I went to the combine with him and really got to see the whole combine live. And he's a dog. So just guys like that, man. You could tell those guys put in the work and they deserve everything that comes their way.
Your email that you sent, you did the extra in front of ordinary. You're extraordinary, dude. Like, you know, you might not have the biggest podcast today, but you're going to have a very big podcast. Why? Because you do the little things. You wrote a great email, right to the point. And real people recognize that. And I immediately recognize that by how you wrote your email, how you took the time, how your follow-up was. That's really important. You did all of those things. You followed up 14 different times where most people quit on the second time. Mm-hmm. You're always going to make it in life when you do things like that. And when anyone sees those, the tenacity, you'll always make it. You're going to have a huge podcast one day. You just got to keep doing what you're doing, living clean, living right. Everything will work out, dude. Everyone has bad days. Everyone has the same 24 hours. If you treat every single person the same, you'll get great results. Maybe not immediately, but long term you will. What I mean by that is whether I'm dealing with, you know, head of the royal family, a CEO of a company, a janitor, a bus driver, a fireman, a policeman, the local person working at the laundromat, it really doesn't matter, even if they're homeless. Everyone's equal. All we are worth one. And everyone's worth one. And if you treat life like that, you'll make great friendships.
This is episode 50. And today I'm joined by the mayor of Radford, Virginia, David Horton. Thank you very much for joining me, Mayor Horton.
Hey, thanks for having me. I appreciate you inviting me on the show and giving us a chance to have a conversation. Find something you're passionate about and spend a good portion of your life supporting it. Find something that you think you can make a difference with and get behind it, because that will enrich your life and it will enrich the lives of your neighbors and the people that you care about. You know, one of the things that I see all the time is that many things that are good in a community and a commonwealth like Virginia and a country like the U.S. are there because people did something to make them happen. It didn't just happen automatically. It didn't just happen magically, that someone was passionate about it and they led the charge for it. They supported it and they told the story and they got others engaged in it. If everybody does that for the things that they truly care about, what a wonderful world this could be.
Left to the bank, I'm like, haha, dada. What she saying? I heard blah, blah, wata. Rocks on me like I'm Tata Baba. Sipping lean like it's aqua, papa. Percocet before you chopper, chopper. When it busts, you hear papa. Doctor, serving patients, I'm a trapper. Rasta, I've been running with some shotas. Go. Smoke a shark lotto in a fishbowl wearing Prada.
Come on, Tata!
You're not that guy, pal. Trust me. You're not that guy.
And I'm joined by Coach Mickey Thompson, legendary football coach in Virginia. 16 district titles, 13 regional championships, 2 state championships, won 83% of his games. And I was lucky enough to play for you for a couple of seasons when I went to Stonebridge.
You know, I guess the first one would be, you know, Ed Wang, who played with the Buffalo Bills, and you know, his recruitment, and he was one of the first big time guys that we had, and his ability to be that big and play out wide and play so many positions. You know, he's the big one that, you know, stands out early. And, you know, if you're looking at the guys, Jaron Gabea is the most intense and best 3-year player we've ever had. He's the guy that, you know, from day one, he had to look, he practiced the way you're supposed to practice every day. And, you know, there's none better than him. And then both my sons, of course, I got to, you know.
Yeah, shout out Patrick and Zach and Joe.
And then later Joe would come in, and you know, those are great times. And Nate Davis, being an O-line guy and somebody who really values that, Nate Davis was just a pleasure. I mean, I knew when he was a sophomore that he was going to play college football, number one. Number two, I thought he had a chance to play pro ball when he was a sophomore. It's one of those things where I was telling people that when he was a sophomore, and you know, I can say, I told you, you know. So those guys, and of course, John Allen, and you know, I've never seen anybody dominate games like he did on the defensive side. I mean, there's nobody, I've never seen a player like that before in my life. So that was pretty exciting. There were times where I just sat and watched. I said, I got to watch some of this because I got to remember some of this stuff, because usually a guy can't take over a game on a defensive side, but he would just take over a game.
Take chances. Go out there. Get involved. Don't. This is your moment to not be afraid to try something new. And if it doesn't work, great. Now you've learned that that's not the thing that works. Go do something else. I love hearing the stories of progression, of how, you know, a student might come in and they're nervous, or they don't feel like they belong, or they don't feel like that this is the place for them. And then they take a chance and they join a club, or they talk to a faculty member after class, or they, you know, take their roommate and let's go, you know, grab ice or whatever. It's something simple, yeah. Right? But right now, I think this, for me, matters even more, because I think we have a whole generation of college students, freshmen, sophomores, particularly right now, who've had their education disrupted and their social experience disrupted, whether or not you spent an entire year online or half a year or whatever it was. I think it's made people more nervous about maybe taking some of those chances because the world seems so uncertain. But trust that the people here have your back. The faculty here have their back. They support the people in student affairs. My goodness, I mean, they couldn't be more excited to help students as they find out sort of who they are. But get involved, go out there and just don't be afraid.
I'm joined by professional MMA fighter Ray Cooper III. He fights for the PFL in the welterweight division, and he's got a massive fight coming up against Rory McDonald in the main event on August 13th.
I'm looking to knock him out in the first round, but if it doesn't, I can go all rounds. I can fight all night long. So, and he's going to be in the world for her this whole the whole fight. So, yeah, but I'm looking for and hunting for a first round knockout.
Yeah, PFL champion, fighting the main event. Do you eventually want to take your career to the UFC and test out the opponents there or the competition?
I'm not too sure. Maybe. We'll see. But right now, I'm fine where I'm at. I feel like I'm making way more than any UFC fighter would be making with 3 years with the company. So yeah, we'll see later on. I don't know if things may happen. We'll see, but right now I'm fine.
Yeah. Is there any people in other organizations? I mean, obviously you're confident you think you can beat every person regardless of promotion, but is there a fight in the welterweight division, whether it's Bellator, UFC or PFL, that you really want to test against or test your skills against?
Yeah. Well, I want to fight the welterweight champion of the UFC, Kamaru Usman. I feel like I can out-wrestle him. His background is wrestling. I feel like I'll out-wrestle him and out-strike him if he wanted to stand. But he likes to stand and trade, but I think if I hit him clean a couple of times, I don't think he'll be standing.
gotta go. Come check the flow.
First episode with a guest in 2021. What better guest to have than my man Tyler Casagrande? Haven't talked to you in a minute, dude, but everything going well?
Yes, sir. Big Mike. Mike Meatball Mar. What's good, brother? Good to
dude,
see you.
I actually have that in the outline. That was going to be at the end of the outline, but hell, dude, we can kick it off with that. So how do we, I mean, we met through Kevin back in the day, but dude, I was this like sixth or seventh grade, right?
Yeah, it was through Kevin Mehidge back in, I think, sixth or seventh grade, middle school, me, you, Kev, Dom Rubino. We'd always kick it, but we were at Mehidge's house one night, and Miss Mehidge made us some spaghetti and meatballs, and she had these big jumbo meatballs from Wegmans, and Big Mike thought he could stuff one down his throat in one bite. Didn't end up well.
Dude, that video, I would pay so much money to watch that video. It's somewhere in the cloud. I mean, I don't know who has
it. I lost it when I got a new phone, but I've tried to look for that video for the last 8 years, and I don't have it. I hope someone does. We need to rekindle that.
That joint's in the cloud somewhere. I had it on my 4, but like you said, when I went from like the 4 to the 5 like 6 years ago, I lost everything. And I feel like you couldn't back up stuff back then. Like if you lost it, it's gone. Like there's no getting that photo back or video.
Yeah, when I play like the clubs, right, they don't really allow people to request songs. Kind of like you play your own music. When I play like a private party, a lot of people request like the music that I make, because sometimes at clubs I'm not allowed to play it or just not fit the vibe. But a lot of people request like my song, like Old School Vibe or That Night when I'm playing a private party. But as for like requested songs, right, it's always some of those big TikTok songs, you know, that people want to hear loud in their face, you know?
Man, fuck those songs. I mean, some of them are good, but some of them are like,
fuck those
some
songs.
Of them are nice. Just like, I don't know. No, what song, what, like, since you started, obviously there's been a million in between, but what are a few songs in your book that just don't miss, period?
Dude, don't miss, huh? Dude, every time you play one of those old school bangers from 2013, like a Tremor, right? Those never miss. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Obviously, they're overplayed. If you can get a remix of it, it's even hotter. But like some of the songs that don't miss, like a Fisher track, like I'm Losing It. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Those we were actually just bumping that a couple weeks ago when I was at the lake.
Yeah.
We just put that on. Yeah, that song doesn't miss. You're right. You got it.
Frosted Flakes, Honey Nut Cheerios is such a terrible question, if I'm being honest, because like, Frosted Flakes are like the first and second best cereal of all time. Like they're so head and shoulders above of anything else.
I know, like it's not even a fair. That's they shouldn't even be in the same like bracket. Like they're completely different.
All right, if we had a little cereal bracket going, like, do you like sugary cereals?
Yeah, for sure.
All right, would you rather have Apple Jacks or Fruit Loops?
Why would Apple? Actually, I don't know. Maybe
exactly. Apple. That's a good question.
I was gonna say, why would you say that? Like Apple Jacks are weird, and then I remembered what they're pretty good.
They bang. I mean, I fucked them big time. All right, Cinnamon Toast Crunch or Frosted Flakes?
Cinnamon Toast Crunch. Actually, it's a way better. I'm laughing because I've never had an. I've never been in an interview where like I'm like ranking.
Well, I mean, it literally just started with Benji. It started with Benji asking Honey Nut Cheerios or Fruit Loops or whatever he said. Frosty
you
Flakes.
Have to leave this in. It's like the most bizarre interview I've ever had in my entire
good.
Life. What were your emotions when you received your first contract to become a professional esports player?
Man, you know, it happened so quick. And I don't know. I really don't even know how I got good at Rocket League looking back at it. Like, I have 4,500 hours in Rocket League as of today. And I almost don't remember, you know, how much, like when I was putting that time in, but it was every day I was playing at Radford, you know, on my days off, I was consistently grinding every night. I had this rule, you know, within my own mindset, I was like, I'm going to play 6 hours a day or put six hours of work into this esports club. Mm-hmm. And so that's what I did every single day, 6 hours at least, you know, whether it be in the morning, in the evenings after class, I was always putting the time in. And to see it pay off, not only with the club, but my professional career as well, I was signed to Shattered Dreams Esports. They're based out of Canada. But that was just the greatest feeling because I had something that I was passionate about, that I was good at, that I could just continue doing, you know, over the next few years. And I saw that opportunity. I was like, this is crazy. Like, I'm making a living for myself out of esports.
Finding something that you're passionate about, because then you're more likely or more willing to put in effort and grind with it. Is there anything you'd say to people that may be struggling finding what their passion is?
Yeah, I would just say that doing college, doing your time on a college campus, that's the opportunity to explore what you want to do long term with your career. And so I know that you're encouraged not to change your major, but I encourage you to take a look. Take a look at some of the things that really excite you, because we have so many students that come to campus and they decide they want to study a certain topic, and it's so much based on what they were told that they should do with their career. And it's important for them to take that step back and figure out what ultimately will make them happy. Because if you find your passion, you're doing something you're excited about, I believe that statement that we've heard so many times, you'll never work a day in your life because you're doing something that means something to you from a personal standpoint. And so I think that is something that's important to do. On a college campus, you have the ability to navigate that. And now with the new real curriculum, that's being implemented here next fall, students are going to have even greater opportunity early in their journey on Radford's campus to figure out what they want to do, because of the ability to move into some majors early, pick up minors in other areas is something that's going to be very, very helpful.
You're never really, like, there's not really a limit to something, you know, in snowboarding. I think, like, you can always improve your tricks, you can always improve your style, you can always, like, film a better video, you can always, like, win another contest. But it's not like I think, like, oh, I gotta win this competition and then, like, my goals are reached. You know, it's more like I enjoy this, I want to keep going, I want to get better, I want to inspire the next generation. And that's really my goal, like, just to be, like, looked up to in snowboarding for until after I quit, you know, like, just be one of the legendary names that I used to look up to. I want to be in that list. That's more so my goal.
How long does it typically take you to write an entire song?
To write an entire song? Well...
Or, like, what's the whole process? Like, maybe not, like, that exact question.
The whole
question.
Process is, first, I like to figure out... This is actually a great question, because people always ask me about my, like, writing, or, like, try to get me to, like, make a video on, like, how I write my songs.
Mm-hmm.
So I think of, like, what I want to write about, and most of the time... They're about boys, or they're about just being sad, or they're about mental health. They're pretty sad, I'm not gonna lie. But a lot of people relate to them. Like, Olivia Rodrigo's album came out, everyone relates to that. Like, it's sad, but, like, everyone relates to it. They have, like, some sort of connection to it. So I try to think of what I want to write about first, and if I try to think on if it fits the ukulele more or the piano, because I do play both instruments. I've been writing more songs on the piano more because it's more emotional.
Now, has anyone ever, like, a stranger, like, whether it's at school or just out in public, like, tested you not knowing that you're a boxer and you have to, like, restrict yourself? Because obviously, like, you could knock them out if you really wanted to. Have you ever had, like, any situations where you've had to, like, control yourself?
It's actually, people try to try you all the time. You know, they'll try you over the internet in person. But I'm really a nice guy, humble dude.
Yeah.
So nobody really presses me like that. Cause, like, you know, if you have an issue with me, that's gonna be weird. Cause, like, what are you mad for? So, but there was this one time I was at LA Fitness playing basketball with my boys, and this dude, you know, I guess he was kind of joking, but his joking was a little too serious. And I took that like, okay, you know, I might have to be on point in a couple seconds. So he was, like, just talking. I just pointed at my socks. I have a custom pair of socks, like, a clear photo of myself with boxing gloves on. So I just pointed at my socks. He's like, oh, you boxed? Oh, I'm just messing with you, dude.
No, like the last 10 minutes of warm-ups is the best, when, like, everybody's in the crowd and stuff. And then, like, that's when you're just doing your, like, layup lines to, like, finish it off.
Yeah.
That's the best, because, like, especially when your knees are feeling good that day, like, you'd be trying, like you'd be doing all the dunks you can do and stuff.
Yeah.
Like, we've had so many of those days where, like, everybody's knees are feeling good. So then everybody's, like, doing cool dunks and, like, warm-ups, and we're all getting hype. And then those games are the best. I love those.
Yeah. What's the craziest dunk that you can do?
I mean, I've done it East Bay before, like put it in between my legs.
Yeah.
I've done like a reverse windmill.
Damn.
That's
a point guard. That's impressive, bro.
Trying to think, honestly, bro. I'm old. My knees can handle all of this. All like, I don't be jumping that much anymore. In high school, when I had good knees, oh man, I used to dunk all the time. Now I'd be relaxing with it.
Yeah, can you actually remember? It's okay if you can't. But the first time that you dunked in a game,
the first time I dunked in a game. Well, if you want to count like a game, I was like sometime in my junior year. I don't remember what game that was, but my first time ever dunking like. Live, like in like actually playing basketball, was I was 16 during the summer. I was 16 during the summer of going into my junior year, and we were just doing like workouts at my school, and we were playing like pickup. And then I just remember there was like a transition, and I was just like, I'm gonna just go for it, and I went for
just
my
rose up.
Yeah, I just rose up, and I got my first dunk. And then after that one dunk, I'm telling you, after that one dunk, like dunking just became so much easier. After I actually did it one time, like I started dunking two hands, like I started doing everything.
Yeah, dude, that's my dream, bro. Before I die, I gotta be able to boom it at least once. You recently signed with a big agent for potentially your MMA career. Is there anything you can tell us about that and who you signed with and the impact it might have?
Yeah, you know, I signed with MAG, their agency. And their deal right now for me is NIL for college. They're looking to represent me for my, you know, name, image, and likeness. And then after college, you know, that deal will be over, and then we'll reconstruct something if I look to get into my MMA career. And I'm looking forward to it. You know, they represent the best guys in the world. They represent Michael Chandler and Logan Storley and all that. So some top guys in the world.
Yeah, a lot of big names. And did you see Chandler side against Gaethje for November?
Yeah, I'm excited. I know Chandler. My dad coached him in college, so I was always around him growing up, and he's one of the, like, hardest workers you'll ever meet. Like, he might in high school, I don't think he ever won a state title, and then he went into college as a walk-on, and then he became, one of the best wrestlers in the country because his work ethic was so tough. He went into that practice room every day to be the best, and it's carried him through life. Now he's in the MMA, and he's finally getting a shot in the UFC, and I think he's the baddest lightweight in the world.
As long as you're having fun, you know, keep doing it. But if it, like, never quit because it's hard, like, quit because it sucks, you know? So, like, keep grinding. Like, do what you do because you like to do it. Don't do it because, like, you have to or you feel obligated or for money. Because, like, all this stuff, like, the amount of time you spend, like, especially just for, like, college sports, it would not be worth it if you didn't enjoy it.
Yeah.
Just, like, basically try to have as much fun as you can and make the most of every opportunity, I guess. I don't know. It's kind of generic, but.
No, yeah. Has there ever been a time in your soccer career where you've, like, really thought about maybe this isn't what I want to do anymore? Or have you always, like, been real focused on
it? I mean, definitely, dude. There's definitely a whole lot of ups and downs. That's what, like, I mean, just in general, I think what's good about sports is it teaches you, like, to not just focus on the negatives. Like, you have a bad day. And, like, at first when I got here, like, being a freshman, some days I won't play well. I was like, if I let it affect the rest of my day, like, it just ruined my life. So I got to focus, like, while I'm playing soccer, focus on soccer. But outside of soccer, like, I try to think about as little as possible, you know?
Can I get 100 chicken nuggets and a small iced coffee, please? Do you think the kid that I'm doing the challenge with, you think he's going to eat all 100 chicken nuggets?
Seriously? Probably not.
Large vanilla iced coffee.
Oh, man. Thank you.
And for all those nuggets, if you can pull forward, we got to make some of them fresh.
Let's run it. Start the timer.
Start
the timer, baby.
Just the.
I'm interested to see your technique getting after it. You said you got a good technique for us?
I
can get 29.
Oh, shit. All right.
Put it on the camera, baby.
Let's go. You did it. Once again, my name is Dennis, and I f*** these nuggets up.
Where the fuck is my second belt?